Okay, so here's the last arc video. How do you calculate and display the differences in aerial units? And this part is pretty easy. We're just going to use the field calculator. This part is maybe a little bit more involved. It involves, the idea of a choropleth map, normalizing the values, the issue of class breaks, and then the color schemes that you use. So the basic idea, though, is we've got what we want. We have our 1940 values and we have our 1960 values, both of which are now in the same aerial units, but we'd like to be able to display the change directly rather than having to do all of this work in our head. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to add a field. And I'm going to call this field just change, and I'll make it a double, just because we have decimals. And I'll say OK. And now I'm going to right click on this and say field calculator. And what I'd like to do, just live dangerously, and I'm going to say I'd like to take the 1960 value for home ownership and subtract from it the aerial weighted value for 1940. So that if it's larger, it represents an increase, and if 1960 is smaller than 1940, it represents a decrease. And then if I say OK, it should just populate these fields. And so we have increases, and then eventually we should also have some decreases. Okay, so now what we'd like to do is visualize that result that we have, and we can go double-click on our layer and go over to quantities and then pick that change field and say apply and OK. And the first result that we've got a few issues with. One is just aesthetically, the boundaries of the polygons are making it actually hard to see our data in these areas that are a very where we have very small tracks. All we're really seeing is the darkness of the lines, so that could be cleared up in terms of legibility. But the larger issue is we're having a hard time interpreting this data because it's not normalized. We're just showing raw counts, and I have a feeling that the change was actually greater here than it was here because this is a smaller unit than this, and I think the reason why this is popping up is kind of as having this kind of class of change is just because it's a large area where, basically more things can happen. So what we'd like to do is kind of control for the aerial differences in our units by normalizing by area. And so the quick and easy way to do that in ARC is when you're in quantities, there's a normalization field, and we could just pick shape area and say apply and OK. And so now see how that difference went away, but now this guy increased. Does that make sense? Because before what we had was this guy and this little guy both seemed like they had the same change, but just this magnitude of change was occurring over a much larger area than this, more or less same magnitude of change there. So by normalizing by area, we control for those kind of aerial differences, and we're starting to really see the kind of the magnitude of change much, much better. There's still a couple things going on. For one thing, I have a hard, I mean, it's a little bit hard. We're talking about change, the increase or decrease in the number of houses per unit area. And what's our per unit area right now? It's square meters, right? Because that's our linear unit. And it's a little bit weird for me to think about the number of houses changing per square meter, right? So it's actually easier for me to kind of think about this in terms of per acre, because you can think about an acre being a fairly large lot, a half acre being a not very large lot, a quarter acre being a very small lot. And so if you have 4 houses per acre, it means that you've had kind of a dense change. And so what we'd like to do is, if we could, not to change, but if we could, it would be nice to change the units of the shape area. I don't think we can directly. So I think you can fool around with this, but another way of basically getting our aerial units to be in something like acres is just to add a field, call it acres, In this case, I'm going to store decimal places because I think it's okay to have a half acre or a quarter acre and that kind of business. And then now I'm going to go to calculate geometry, live dangerously, and I want my area, but I want my area to be in acres. Don't get suckered into areas, you want acres, right? And say okay, live dangerously, and then there's that. So now when I go to the properties and go to symbology, I can normalize by acres, and now it's getting to be more reasonable, right? Now I'm talking about the numbers represent the number of houses per acre that are increasing or decreasing, and that's a little bit easier for me to kind of to wrap my head around. Now let's see if I can get rid of these boundary lines, and the easiest way to do that is I want to change the lines for all of these patches at once. It's a drag to go in and change each one individually, but if you click on the symbol tab and go to properties for all symbols, you can just change the outline color to null and say okay. And in a way, I'm comfortable getting rid of the tract lines in this case because we've re-aggregated anyway, and so what's not important here really is the change in each individual tract. What's important here is just where there's certain types of change. I don't know if that makes sense, but I'm comfortable getting rid of the boundaries in this case, because we've been struggling to kind of, you know, put the idiosyncrasies of the boundary in the background by re-aggregating. Okay, so this is getting to be a little bit better, but I'd still like right now to change the classes. These seem to be just arbitrary classes that got spit out by Arc, and I'd like it to be a little bit more rational. What I'd really like to see is, can we first kind of identify places that don't change, that have roughly zero change, and then can we also distinguish places that decreased from places that increased? And we're going to need to do this both by kind of changing the way that we have the data classified, but I think also changing the way that we're using color to symbolize the classification scheme. Right now we have a sequential color ramp that goes from light to dark, and what I'd like is a diverging ramp. I'd like something that kind of hangs on something neutral at zero and then maybe gets cool as it decreases and gets hot as it increases, right? And that would be kind of a diverging color scheme. Okay, so let's start with trying to get the classes to work. If I go over to classify, here's the histogram. So here represents the number of polygons that have these that have been binned in these data values. And what I can do is, and there, here are the break values over here. So one thing is I can just drag these guys around and kind of try to group, try to create bins manually like that. But what we're seeing is, okay, we seem to have, maybe what I can say is that I want, a negative 0.5 as one break, and that's going to get the places that decreased kind of the most by more than half a house per acre. And then I'd like to get maybe something just less than zero here. And then I could get something just greater than zero here. And so now anything between this is basically no change, right? Because this is going to capture basically the pixels that have zero value. And then maybe I could have a little bit more than just two classes to change. It'd be nice to get maybe 0.5, and then, I'd like to have maybe another class in here that says three houses, and then anything more than three houses per acre. Okay, so how would I do that? Well, I would have to change the number of classes, and it's not letting me do that right now, but if I get out of manual, then I can change it, and then if I just go back here and say, look, I'd like this guy to be that. I'd like this guy to be negative, just less than there, zero. This guy to be just greater than zero. This guy to be not much change. This guy to be three houses. And then that guy to be four. Okay. Can you handle that? And apply it. And what does that get me? Okay. So now, that's starting to be interesting, but I'm still stuck on this sequential ramp, color ramp. Can I make it diverging by having this guy, if there's no change, let's just make it white. And if it decreases, let's make it a light blue if it decreases just a little bit, and maybe a darker blue if it decreases a little bit more. And then let's have this be a light red, and then this be a slightly increasing red, and then this be the darkest red, and hit apply. Okay, and I'm starting to get a diverging scheme. I've kind of lost some things. What's going on out here? Can I get, let's see, let's if I make the pop, no color, but a gray outline, is that gonna help? And turn it on? Okay, so now at least I can see the outlines of things like the islands out here. It's not perfect because it's underneath, but for just kind of visualizing this, it's helping me a little bit. And so now let's try to interpret this by going up and grabbing our add data, the world imagery, and add that. And so what are the places that didn't seem to change? Well, San Clemente Island, which makes sense because it's a military establishment. Santa Catalina Island only changed in this one spot. And do you know what this one spot is? It increased here. And this is actually Avalon, right? So this is a harbor on Catalina that has a private development that occurred beginning, I think, in the 20s, but it looked like the development here increased. Right, according to this, it increased in the post-war era. Okay, so what else seemed, so those are places that kind of didn't change. This place didn't change, and this didn't change. Do you know what that place is? Well, it looks like it's part of the mountains, and this is also part of the mountains. So this might be national forest, and that might be national forest. What seemed to decrease? Well, let's go here. This area seemed to decrease in private housing. What is it? Do you recognize this? It's kind of a fun image to drill into. It's kind of an amazing image, actually. Do you know what's going on, what these things are? So it's that kind of an area. What's this area that also decreased? Do you know what that is? And then what else decreased? Well, this area here. So what's this area if I zoom in? Oh, don't fail me now, Ark. Come on, it's not that difficult. Please? Okay, just a little heat flash there, but do you recognize this kind of a pattern? And how this differs from this? So what we, the three things that we've looked at are basically one was a loading zone for containers on ships, the other was an airport, and this last thing that we looked at is also kind of industrial land use. And so one of the things that you see happening in the post-war era is this kind of functional segregation of the landscape, where you're starting to get kind of industrial zones and commercial zones separated from residential zones. And so now let's kind of cruise in and look at, you know, what is this place? And like this is, oh, we've lost it, but we should be able to see it here. It is not the topmost. I'm interested in pop. What is this guy on pop? And it's California, Los Angeles, Long Beach. So if we look at Long Beach, you'll start seeing that this deep red is this classic Southern California suburban swimming pool in the backyard neighborhood that's became very widespread in the post-war era as part of the kind of the rise of the middle class and the ability of kind of working folks to be able to, and returning veterans to be able to purchase their own housing. You also see the San Fernando Valley beginning to suburbanize at this time, right? And so it's that was the, okay, so that's That's it. I'm running out of time on this one, and I'm going to make a couple of videos on Sunday to show you how to do this in quantum.